Welcome to The Facts. I'm Mike Austad. This week, we are going to be talking about the 10 ballot measures facing South Dakota voters on Tuesday, November 8th. My guest today is Steve Haugaard, representative of the Legislature District 10. Welcome.
Thanks very much for having me.
Steve, tell us a little bit about the position in the legislature and what your title is and what you do when you go to peer.
I was elected in 2014 to the South Dakota House of Representatives District 10. That's Brandon and the Renner area in Northeast Sioux Falls. And our duties are to go out and to hear the bills that are proposed in the legislature, consider the different issues involved in those bills, and to vote yay or nay on them. And also, South Dakota has the unique situation where we hear all of the bills that are proposed. They go through a committee, so they actually get a committee hearing, and if they're passed through the committee, then they go to the floor of the House and the floor of the Senate.
Okay. And of the legislature, there's 105 members throughout the state between the Senate chamber and the House chamber. You're in the House. What is your daytime job? Are you what do you do most of the year, or what's your experience in life and education?
Well, I've practiced law here in Sioux Falls since 1983, and so that's my primary obligation. But with the legislature, I find it, you know, it's a part-time job, but it can be a full-time job too in a lot of ways. Throughout the year, I'll be involved in different meetings with this summer, for example, being on a summer study for substance abuse, and then throughout the year trying to hear what constituents have to say and what bills might come up in the coming session, and to draft legislation that will be considered in the 2017 session.
So with your law background, there's a lot of issues that are facing the voters direct. These 10 ballot questions, these voters are going to have a chance to answer 10 questions that are going to affect direct, either by a constitutional amendment, an initiated measure, or a
referred law.
Let's go with the first things that are going to face the voters on the 10 questions are constitutional amendments. Tell me the weight and what that means by the constitutional amendment that people will be deciding.
Well, a constitutional amendment, as it indicates, is affecting the Constitution, the very foundational document of our state. And so when you revise that, it has far-reaching impact, and it means that it changes that foundational document such that the Supreme Court then would interpret the application of that if it ever comes to the Supreme Court. A referred law or an initiated measure, those become statutory issues, and those are things we can address in the legislature and change or modify as we would need to. An amendment is something altogether different, and once it's in the Constitution, the only way to revise that is to have it back on the ballot again. So those amendments have a dramatic impact on the state, and if you don't understand all the nuances of the amendment and its impact as it's going to be applied, then you face a monumental task of coming back in a couple of years to revisit that amendment.
So there could be court challenges, unintended consequences. When people go to the ballot, they're going to be able to vote for the House, the Senate, what's popular on TV, of what the political issues are. They're going to have these 10 questions. Do you have any suggestions for people, South Dakota voters, of what they should do if they're not aware of these issues when they show up at the polling booth?
Well, a well-informed voter should go to the Secretary of State's website and read all the information that's available there, both the measure itself, the words of the measure itself, and then find out who's proposing it, who's against it, and then take a look at the different websites that are available to gather as much information as possible. And then it'd be great if they want to call their representative or their senator and they can talk to them about it as well. Gather as much information as you can, make a well-informed decision. Sadly, most people just don't have the time, and this has always been my experience, that you review these things in preparation for voting, but you might not understand all the nuances of the proposal. And so if you have the time to read it, great. If you don't, my suggestion is that you'd vote no on those things to leave it as it is.
Okay. And some of those options we're going to have, I have a sample ballot for Minnehaha County that all voters will face, be similar throughout the state, 2 pages. Most of these, majority of the, besides the President and the Senate and the House, most of these issues are going to be ballot questions. And some of them have 3 to 4 paragraph explanations that the voters are be able to read and make decisions on. So a lot of this material are these 10 ballot measures, and some of them are a little bit ambiguous. That's what we want to get into. And the first few questions, the first few ballot measures that we are the voters of South Dakota will be able to opt for are constitutional amendments, the ones with the strong teeth. Let's go through the first one that the voters will face is Constitutional Amendment R, dubbed the tech schools, and changing the way that direction of the tech schools are regulated and fundraising.
Well, on R, I take the general position if a voter is not aware of the proposals on the ballot and you haven't had the time to review it, I take the general position of no. On this one specifically, I think this is something the legislature can address in a broader legislative context and then potentially refer that on to the voters for a final vote after it's had enough airing. But this is an amendment to the Constitution that would shift the oversight of vocational technical training. One of the things that I have a little difficulty with is the very idea of vocational training in South Dakota itself, as far as the state's authority and the state's role in vocational training. This simply addresses who's going to oversee that. It wants to make it shift it from the school boards where it is now to a different category. But my concern about vocational training in South Dakota is it's not part of what the Constitution requires as far as an education. And I know that people see an education as being much broader than just the three R's. But this goes beyond the scope, or technical training in general goes beyond the scope of what the Constitution calls for. This is a significant change that would set up an independent board and create, again, a new board. It would take it out of the hands of oversight by elected officials. Right now, you still have school boards that address some of these issues, as opposed to what this would propose, which would be an independent commission or committee that would oversee the vocational schools, and that would be not by elected officials, but by appointed officials.
So if this passes, it could affect budget constraints and taxes and things that could open up a whole new...
Well, it would certainly affect the budget, and it will go on affecting the budget whether it's under this form or not. But again, this ends up being a separate commission of non-elected individuals who might feel beholden to whomever is appointing them. So with that in mind, I think voters should be concerned about making that change. And again, it's a constitutional amendment. It's a significant change, and it's not going to be revised until maybe 2 years later. By that time, all this is already implemented, and you've got an issue to deal with there trying to unring the bell.
Coming up next on The Facts, we're going to be getting into more of these ballot questions. We'll return in a moment.
I've heard the truth. Know what I wanted, the answers.
You are the only one I trust.
Welcome back to The Facts. My guest, Steve Haugaard, with the South Dakota State Legislature. And Steve, looking at your bio, we're going into these constitutional amendments and the law and the minutiae. Shows here you've got a Juris degree, you've got your law degree from Puget Sound in Tacoma, Washington. And your experience in South Dakota law for how long?
Since 1983, so 33 years this year. I grew up near Madison on a farm, attended SDSU, and then when I got ready to go to law school, I thought it'd be an opportunity to live somewhere else and see what life is like elsewhere in the country. So my wife and I moved out there, and we lived in Washington for just short of 3 years and enjoyed that. Good opportunity, met a lot of interesting people and made a lot of good lifelong contacts. So it was a good opportunity. And also I felt if I was going to practice law in South Dakota, I should probably go somewhere where at least I had to take a bar exam at some point in the future. At that time, the University of South Dakota didn't require it. And so if you graduated from law school there, you could automatically practice law in South Dakota, but I thought I should be able to at least pass the bar. And so that's what I did and came back, and I've enjoyed being here in Sioux Falls for 33 years.
Okay. We're on number two, Constitutional Amendment S. Some of these explanations here are three or four paragraphs by the Attorney General. With your experience in the law, let's summarize Constitutional Amendment S, or Marcy's Law, victims' rights.
Well, Marcy's Law is a provision that actually amends the Constitution, so writes it into the Constitution that victims would have specified rights. And on the surface, it seems like a good idea. But when you dig down and take a look, you find the problems with it. And I just point out that people usually trust their own attorney. They might not trust the rest of the attorneys, but they trust their own attorney. And by and large, I don't think there are more than a handful of attorneys who would support this just because of the complications that it creates. In Marcy's Law, I've printed out here as far as what actually is being proposed as an amendment to the Constitution, and there are 19 specific paragraphs referencing particular rights, and then three paragraphs that follow that, expanding on who is a victim and that sort of thing. And I'll just point out as we go through here, the victims, it talks about the right to due process and to be treated with fairness and respect for the victim's dignity. Well, it's kind of hard to define what a victim's dignity is. So you see an initial problem there. There's not a definition associated with dignity. And the right of the victim to be free from intimidation, harassment, and abuse. Again, these are broad terms that you certainly want to protect victims of a crime, but you don't want to hamstring the court system so that it can't deal quickly and efficiently with these prosecutions. It talks about the right to disclosure of right to prevent disclosure of information or records that could be used to locate or harass a victim. You certainly don't want that to happen, but this particular item is in direct conflict with the right of the defendant to actually defend themselves and to gather enough information to know who we're talking about what the elements of the crime are. So that paragraph in itself, I think, could be fraught with problems as far as when a defendant is trying to prepare their defense, but they can't access certain information. And it's not as though they should have a right to know where somebody is so they can target them. But it is that they need to know the details of the allegations. So many times, especially these days with the types of crimes that we see, you'll have reports of individuals living in a particular location, but you don't know how many individuals were in that residence. There could have been 10 people living there. And if you can't even detail the location of some of the potential witnesses and gather information and try to provide a credible defense, you've impaired the rights of the defendant in that case. And my experience throughout these 33 years is our state's attorneys, who also are opposed to this constitutional amendment, our state's attorneys do a great job of ensuring that victims get the protection they need and are provided with timely notice of all the proceedings that really impact their life. You know, this amendment goes beyond that, and it says that the victim actually has the right to refuse an interview, deposition, or other discovery requests. You know, so the victim wouldn't even be forced to disclose all the information that the individual is being charged. They wouldn't have an opportunity to defend themselves. So those are issues. It talks about the right to be heard in any proceeding involving release, plea, sentencing, adjudication, disposition, or parole. What oftentimes happens, especially in Minnehaha County, is that these proceedings will be scheduled and there will be continuances provided, continuances requested, maybe the day before a proceeding, and the victim under this constitutional amendment would have the right to be engaged in whether or not that continuance is granted. And this goes all the way down in the level of crime. So it's so far-reaching that it would hamstring the state's attorney and the judges in making decisions as far as sentencing and resolving these cases. Right now, the judges have the freedom to make a judgment call as to whether or not the bond should be reduced or they should be allowed a continuance. In this case, the victims would be engaged in all those steps along the way if they chose to be.
So, as you said, the most of the state's attorneys and the Bar Association South Dakota oppose this. It would be a drain on their resources. Is there other state precedents where this law has been in effect in other areas?
Well, I don't think this particular law, I might be wrong, but I don't think this particular law is in effect in any other state just exactly as it's crafted here. You know, each state is going to have some enumeration of rights for both defendants and likely for victims, especially for restitution, that sort of thing. So the enumeration of rights here, as I mentioned before, is extremely broad and has the potential for slowing down the process of criminal cases and creating unreasonable cost to the taxpayers. And there isn't anybody that I know of in South Dakota who's crying for this. This is funded by out-of-state source, one out-of-state source. My understanding, a billionaire out of California, I looked at the money that's gone into this recently, and it's approximately $750,000 and probably more coming in now. And about two-thirds of $1 million has already been spent. So the rest will be spent in these next weeks on more television advertising. But it's this one individual's interest to change this law in South Dakota. And I think what happens is a lot of times people from out of state, several of these measures on the ballot are being sponsored by out-of-state interests. They see South Dakota as an easy mark for them to come in, get a law passed, and then be able to go to another state and say, hey, it already passed over here, so let's go with that same trend and show some credibility in the passage of the law. But in Minnehaha County, for example, we had, I believe, is over 48,000 charges last year, which boiled down to probably about 8,000 to 10,000 individual cases. So you've got 8,000 to 10,000 individuals you're trying to process through the system. And the state's attorney, as I said before, does a great job of keeping in touch with victims, making sure restitution gets funneled into the right direction. And if you had to provide additional notices and coordinate with the victim in all these cases, if you're going to reschedule a hearing, if you're going to change bond, if you're going to do anything with this defendant, if you had to coordinate with those individual victims, you would just paralyze the system as we've got it going right now. It's bad enough the way it is, but this would make it that much worse. You don't want to have victims unaware of a rapist being released or a murderer being released or some other aggressive, assaultive individual being released from custody without the victim knowing. But that's not been the case in South Dakota. So this is, as they say, a solution looking for a problem. And it's not even a good solution. It's so broad that it would create, I think, undue expense to the state. And I don't think it would be effective in accomplishing its goals. I think it would consume so many resources that victims would probably find themselves being very frustrated by the delays that would come into play.
Thank you, Steve, for the description on Amendment S. We'll be back in return with the next issues facing the South Dakota voters.
Meet the Lion Hillary doll. Press her and she'll tell one of her unbelievable tales.
When I got off the plane in Bosnia, I had to dodge sniper fire.
I made a mistake and, you know, I had a different memory and my, my staff and others have, all kind of come together trying to sort out. So I made a mistake.
Not a single one of my emails was classified.
Documents are being upgraded at the request of the intelligence community because they contain a category of top secret information.
That I was closing down the coal mines was all taken out of context.
We're going to put a lot of coal miners and coal companies out of business.
It's just a security inquiry. There's no FBI criminal investigation.
I'm not familiar with the term security inquiry. We're conducting an investigation. That's what we do.
I don't believe I ever lied to the public.
I don't know why that's funny.
Get your Lion Hillary doll today. Press her and she'll tell 18 unbelievable tales. Only $24.99, includes free shipping. Order today at www.lionhillarydoll.com.
Welcome back to the Facts. Returning to the 10 ballot questions that'll be facing South Dakota voters. Next one we're discussing is number 3, is the legislative redistricting mandate or constitutional amendment T. Steve, what is your input on that?
Well, I would vote no on that as well. Again, that's the constitutional amendment. And the problem with this one is that it forces a new redistricting before the end of the 10 years that normally would take place. And this redistricting, again, is one of those issues where they think they're going to accomplish something that they're not. And the fact is the last redistricting ended up with a redistricting where there was general satisfaction that the districts were well balanced. And in fact, it benefited the Democrats in the sense that they gained a few seats because some of the incumbent Republicans were districted out of their district, in a sense. So the last time this was submitted, it ran through the justice system that the U.S. Justice Department was satisfied that it properly treated the Native Americans. The ACLU was satisfied that it properly treated everyone. And it was a bipartisan effort, and there was satisfaction that this accomplished the goal without this kind of a revisit at this time. This would just be expensive, and it would not accomplish what they're hoping it would.
Next, we have Constitutional Amendment U.
Well, Constitutional Amendment U is one of these issues on the ballot that deals with the interest rates, the payday lending organizations. And U was a response to the other bill, which is initiated Measure 21.
That's coming up later on the choice, too, isn't it?
It is. And so U was brought forward to try to provide some sort of a response that voters might understand. But neither of these are crystal clear. Both of them suggest they're trying to cap interest rates. But the goal with U is to create an exception, which may not be a bad exception. The proponents of initiated Measure 21 suggest this is a loophole, and in a sense it is. It talks about capping 18% or rates at 18%, which is less than the credit card companies provide, and it's probably less than most banks will charge in fees and expenses if you have an overdraft. But the point of U is that it says that it caps it at 18%, but you can, with notice on the form that you'll use for lending, you can acknowledge that you are willing to pay more than the 18%.
Constitutional Amendment V, hiding party affiliation on primary elections. Tell us a little bit more about that.
Well, Constitutional Amendment V, again, being a constitutional amendment, I'm concerned about it. I don't think that it provides an adequate opportunity for the voters to understand fully the ramifications of this. And it sounds nice in a sense, but what it would do is it actually exclude, most of the time, would exclude independent voters from seeing a candidate on the ballot that they're interested in. The two main parties, of course, the Republicans and Democrats, would be running their candidates. The independents would run as best they could, but only those that make it through the primary, the top vote-getters out of, say, in an individual race, two top vote-getters out of the primaries would end up on the general ballot in the fall. So the independent parties would thereby not end up having an opportunity to be on the ballot. So I think it has ramifications that are just not in the best interest of the voters of South Dakota.
All right, and moving on to the initiated measures, they've got less strength on the foundation of changing South Dakota law. They're not constitutional amendments, but they're initiated measures. Initiated measure number 22 is campaign financing for publicly funded elections would now be taken over publicly?
Yeah, initiated Measure 22, I printed the entirety of that just to make reference to it. It is 34 pages of new law, and it's bad enough passing one paragraph laws because of the issues that they might create, but we're talking about 34 pages of revisions and proposals to be added to our statutes. And the idea of initiated Measure 22 is that they somehow want to get campaign financing under control. They then also want to create an ethics commission. They want to appropriate funds for campaigns. And in fact, the the measure as it's proposed is not adequately funded. If all the voters showed up and voted, there wouldn't be enough money to cover this thing. Because they're talking about each voter would have so many dollars to allocate toward a candidate. And the idea of doing that would ultimately end up being far more than the, I think, $12 million they were talking about. It'd be something like $25 million per campaign cycle. And the voters don't need to be forking out that money. Right now, candidates individually can fund their own campaigns. They can go out and ask friends and family for contributions. Sadly, a lot of the contributions do come from special interests. And that has to be considered as to whether or not it's the source you want to receive money from, or if there's an underlying intention with the campaign contributions. But be that as it may, it's still privately funded, whereas this would take taxpayer dollars and use them for campaigns that end up printing glossy brochures or glitzy ads. And that's not where taxpayer money should be going. It should be going to schools and roads and everything else that we need to do.
The eighth of 10 ballot measure that will be facing South Dakota voters is initiated measure number 23. It's kind of ambiguous. It's called an initiative measure to give certain organizations the right to charge fees. Where does this really coming from, and who are they talking about when we read this?
Problem with this is that it's so brief that on the surface it looks like this wouldn't really have an impact on anything. But the words of the initiated measure are exactly this. And the point of this is that the nonprofit or a corporate organization could actually charge a fee for a service they provide. Sounds good on the surface. The backside of this is that the first phrase in that initiated measure in Section 1, it says, notwithstanding any other provisions of law. So it says, forget everything else. An organization, whether it's corporate or nonprofit, has the right to charge a fee for any service provided by the organization. Sounds okay. Sounds like you should pass that. But what that does, because of the first phrase in the paragraph, it says, notwithstanding any other provisions of law, it says, forget about all the other law that protects the right to work in this state and protects individual employees from choosing not to be a member of a union. Forget those things. If an organization is doing something that is a service, whether it helps that individual or not, or whether that individual wants that service or not, that organization, whether it's a corporate organization or nonprofit, can charge a fee, which means in South Dakota, if you opt to be excluded from the union in whatever shop you might be working in, if you don't want to be part of the union, in South Dakota you don't have to be. They can't force you into a union. Right. This would say, regardless of any other law that's on the books about having the right to be excluded from the union, you're going to pay the fee for whatever we say is our service to you. And in this case, a union due, for example, would not necessarily be a benefit to you. They might have negotiated a very poor contract. They might have done a lot of things that you didn't want them to do. But this would be a provision that would say, regardless of that, they're an organization, they're providing some kind of a service, they think that you're benefiting from it, so you're going to pay the fees. So that's all this is about, is it's a union provision funded from out of state, and it's just trying to skirt below the surface here enough so that unions can grow and thrive in South Dakota.
You can read into it, this is unions, it's not a private, it's not just an ambiguous private nonprofit. This is being pushed by the unions to force a person, employee, to pay for representation, whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, whether they request it or not, they would still have to pay against their will. Because overall it might be a union shop, even though some of those rank and file people might not be members.
That's correct. And individuals may have a variety of reasons why they don't want to be part of the union. And this would compel them to pay that union to be involved in their life, whether they wanted it there or not. And again, this just takes away the idea that individuals should be able to chart their own destiny in South Dakota. And And this is a, by compulsion, requirement to pay fees to those union organizations, and that's all this is about. Doesn't say that any place in here, but that's the driver behind this.
Very good. Moving on, number 9 of 10 is referred law 19, is a kind of a cleanup for petition filing and date changes and signature rules for candidates seeking office, revising state laws on elections and election petitions. What's your analysis of that?
Well, I think it's something that if it passes in the future, it needs to be aired out a little bit better. There are issues in regard to how you actually get your, how and when you get your petitions filed and delivered to the Secretary of State. We can live with what we have right now. It'd be better just to take a view of this, that this needs a little more attention. When you've got 10 ballot measures that we're facing at a given time, I don't think anyone has adequate time to really fully explore the consequences of these things. So I would, even though this is supported by the Republican majority leader, I'd say just vote no on this at this time. We can sort through this and work on this a little bit more, provide a little more information to voters on it so they can understand it's not something behind the scenes that's nefarious, but it's something that we might need to do, but again, needs to be aired out a little bit better in the public eye.
Okay. Moving on to the final referred law, the 10th, number 10 of 10, referred law 20 is lowering the minimum wage for workers in South Dakota under the age of 18. Right now, the minimum wage is $8.55 an hour. I think the law might have been changed to raise that for minimum wage also for those under 18.
That's correct.
So this is in response to that?
It is. As you go to different places in any town in South Dakota, you know that the business owners struggle to keep enough employees, number one, to keep enough employees working there, much less having to pay more than they can actually afford to pay them. And like all of us experienced in the past, it's good to have an entry-level job where you can try something and you can gain some work experience, you understand how you get to work on time and the expectations of an employer. Those are all good things. And we actually passed this through the legislature. I voted in favor of it, so this is an exception that I would say vote yes on this. But if the voter is just unclear about any of these things, vote no. And the reason probably to vote no is that, again, this is one of those unintended consequences from a previous ballot measure where the minimum wage was set, and then it's set and it has a factoring issue with the cost of living and those kinds of things, so that it'll continue to change on a regular basis. That's certainly not to the benefit of the young worker that's looking for his first job. And that's why it passed through the legislature. Like I say, this is an unintended consequence of passing something before that sounded good, the idea of everybody should be able to make a living wage. Well, entry-level jobs are just that. They're entry-level. They're intended to be the first job or, you know, something where you gain those skills. So the legislature tried to address that. I think that it should have, a broader discussion so the voters know, you know, we need to make some changes here. Could do it through this, and so I may vote yes on this one, but I just think the voters need to be better informed and probably talk to some business owners, get personal feedback about how it impacts the guy that's running a convenience store, or he's running a small business, any place in South Dakota. You know, if you have to say instead of having 10 employees, you're going to hire only 7 because you can't afford to pay 10 employees that higher minimum wage, that affects 3 people there. So they should talk to business owners. They should get an idea of what's the reality of this, because most people don't have a payroll that they're responsible for. So when they talk to a business owner, they'll come to understand better what impact this minimum wage law has.
Steve Haugaard, our guest this week from District 10, South Dakota State Representative. Appreciate you being on the show.
Thanks very much, Mike. I appreciate it.
We'll see you next week for more on The Facts.